We're not actors or TV personalities. We're just a couple of guys who want to show you how to restore your car. Sometimes we mess up. Sometimes we consult the pros. It's never a problem. It's always a project.
Up next on Auto Resto Mod, Jeff installs custom seat belts, and Vinny trades the goon for an HHR. What? Oh, somebody's fixing to die.
Order a bunch of parts to get ready for the car show this weekend?
And I got a hot deal, too.
You think? Think again.
Oh, man.
Tired of back orders? You need NPD. With four strategically located superstores, orders are shipped direct to your door within 1 to 3 business days. National Parts Depot has quality restoration parts for Ford truck, Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, and Firebird. For your free catalog, visit NPD online or call toll free.
Hey, Jeff, guess what? Vinny, he decided we needed a more practical car, so he sold your wagon.
For $500.
For this cool new HHR.
$500?
$500.
$500.
That was a crazy dream. I better go get to work.
Well, you can see we've been busy little beavers since last week. We've got our headliner in. The one thing we don't have done on our headliner is the fact that we don't have our visors in yet, and that's simply because I failed to order them. We've got the visors coming in from National Parts Depot. Now, basically, the Mustang and the Fairlane shared a visor, so those are on the way. We've got other things that we're going to be doing as well. One of those things is we're going to be installing a hidden antenna from the guys at RetroSound. Now, they've got a hidden antenna that we're going to be using underneath the dash pad, so we won't be putting our dash pad in until we get this done. One of the other things that we've got going on here is we're doing the belts. Now, we're actually kind of working a little weird here. I wanted to go ahead and get the windshield done last week and do the belts this week, and the reason for that is this. I did the belts prior to putting the headliner in and the windshield because I didn't want to have any sparks flying up on any of those parts. If you're going to do the belt system in a car like we're doing it with weld-in plates, you'll definitely want to do that before you put those items in the car, or do like Gary and the guys at Mustang Central did when they were doing the floor pan in the 68 Mustang a while back, and actually put up dams and barriers made out of cardboard so you don't get sparks all over your crater grain and actually make craters in your crater grain, which wouldn't be good. So what we're going to do right now is we're going to get real busy going ahead and getting the belts done and basically finish that part of the car up so we'll have a way to go down the road and not get a ticket for not wearing our belts. All right, specialty tools this week, pretty straightforward. You're gonna need a step drill bit. Now, you'll be using this to drill all the holes in the chassis that you need for the seat belts that we're installing on our wagon. You'll also probably be needing one of these. Now, if you're like me and you're going to use a MIG welder, which is incidentally one of our specialty tools, you're probably also going to need a high-speed cutoff wheel and a carbide bit and a sanding disc and a cutoff wheel like this because, well, I'll be honest with you, I basically suck at welding. But I have the welder, and I'm going to use it.
The same folks that brought us RetroSound have a division called RetroBelt. This is a really cool seat belt system. You can put it in almost any vintage car. Now, what we have in front of us on the table is actually two different kits. You have the seat belt kit itself, and then a hardware kit. I highly recommend you get the hardware kit because then you know you have the exact pieces you need for your make and model. And one other thing with the hardware kit, that includes all the washers and the different brackets that you might need for your application. And in my opinion, I want new hardware. That's the difference between saving my life or kissing the steering wheel if I'm in an accident. One important fact when you go to order your seatbelt kit is you definitely want to make sure you get the right piece for the receiver of the seatbelt. This is for a bucket seat. It would just bolt right on the side, or you have just the strap with a bolt point for your regular bench seat. Jeff's going to go into a lot more details as he installs this set in the wagon.
Okay, so we've talked about the retro belts we're going to be using in the Fairlane, not necessarily in detail, but a little bit. And what we're doing here is a little bit custom. Now, we've already started working on this off camera on the passenger side of the car, but I wanted to go over the process I went through in order to arrive at the position I'm using. Now, we've got a set of belts already in here back behind me. Now, the mounting location that you're seeing here is the stock location for the shoulder belts in a 69 Fairlane. And that would be in a Fairlane wagon, in a Fairlane four-door, or a Fairlane two-door. Now, this is going to be something you're going to run into no matter what kind of car you're working on. It doesn't necessarily matter if it's a Fairlane. It's just about an old car. The mounting positions, a lot of times on these cars, really sucked. And I'm going to show you how. You take your belt and you pull it forward and you buckle it in. And guess what? You're about to strangle yourself with your own belt. A lot of times this happened on these older belts. It's uncomfortable, it runs into my neck. Even if you had a position that allowed the belt to move over a little bit, it's still running right across the top of your clavicle. That's not a good position. And no matter where I mounted this thing, inside the upper part of the car, it just didn't work. So we came across another way to do that, and I'm going to show you that in just a second. Well, okay, so now we've gone in and clamped the bracket that we're going to be welding into the car to the B-pillar here in the position I think the belt's going to be the best fit. And the nice thing is it puts the belt right at your hand, like in a modern car, and when you pull the belt around into your body and buckle in, that puts the belt right across the area of the space between the clavicle here and your shoulder mass. The nice thing about that is this, whenever you're going and you, God forbid, have an accident, it's going to push into that area between, and you may separate a shoulder, but you're not going to bust your clavicle like you would with the original position on these belts. This is a really good mount position. If you think about most modern cars, this is exactly where most of them sit. So if you're working on a four-door of any kind or a station wagon of any kind, your B-pillar is probably the best mounting spot for your belts. If you're working on a hard top or something like that, you're going to have a tough time because it's actually going to have to go in this position that we have it right here, and you simply don't have that in a hard top or even in a sedan with a post back there because the post is actually further back. But it gives you an idea of what you might want to try to do for mounting your belts. There is a way to get this in a hard top, but we don't have time to go into that today. We'll probably hit that with the 64 Falcon we'll be working on in the future. But for now, we're going to go ahead and get started with showing you how to mount this up using a MIG welder. Okay, we've got our B-pillar measured out both for height and for center line. Now what I like to use, because I'm not real great at this kind of measuring stuff, I like to actually use a centering tape. You can get these at a lot of the hobby stores. It just makes your life a lot easier if you're doing this. Because quite frankly, what we're measuring out on our B-pillar may not be the same thing on your particular car. And ours basically measured out at about 5 inches off the top of the B-pillar here. At the front and rear, so we've put little marks in here with our white colored pencil, and then we are at three and 3/8 across the width here, so we marked our center line for that, and then we also marked up our plate for the center line of the hole, which needs to go in that middle portion. I'll say this, whenever you're doing this, you need to make sure you have a pillar setup like this one is on the car. In other words, it needs to have a place for that bolt to go into, and usually this is in the center of your B pillar. So you want to make sure that you got enough depth first thing to work with here if you're going to be putting belts in like we're doing. And then, like I said, we've got this marked, and we're going to have to go and trim both the front and back of this so it doesn't overlap, and then weld this into position. Now, we'll say this about welding. If you're not comfortable welding or you don't have a welder set up, go ahead and make all of your cuts, get everything ready to go, and then take it to a shop and have them weld this stuff in for you. It's just gonna be a lot less headache for you. Tell them you need a really nice, neat, pretty weld, and they probably won't even charge you that money to do it. Certainly less than a new MIG welder is gonna cost you if you go out and try to buy one. But what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna take my little piece here and I'm gonna go over and cut it down with a hacksaw, get it ready to go in here so that we can show you how to cut the holes and measure a plate in. All right, so I've cut down the metal piece that's going to go and be welded right here.
Made an angle cut to match this front because it's actually angling back toward the back of the car a little bit, and basically gone in and just filed it down, made it really nice. Now what I'm going to do is I've gone in and marked my 5 inches across here. This is my center line there. So I take that L out of the way and I take my piece here and I put it in backwards with a mark for the center line of the hole up against that line. And what I've got is a centering punch. Now I'm going to put that in the hole, just give it a light tap. Now I'm going to use a center punch. Okay, now I've got my line on my center. Check it, make sure it's good. It is good. Okay, now we got our drill motor set up and we've got a step drill bit and we're going to go to 5/8. Okay, I'm going to put on my safety glasses. So we're going to go in now and start making our hole for the bracket itself. I'm going to make a check to make sure whether or not my bracket is ready to go in. Yep. Okay, now we're set up with that. So now the fun begins. I get to start welding. Or maybe I should say I have to start welding. First, what I want to do though before I weld is I'm going to go in and sand all this clean. Sand me a spot on the B-pillar here for my clamp. I'll probably pull this down and do it down here or back here somewhere so that I've got good clean metal for both my welding position and for my clamp position back here. We'll be able to mount this on here using our C-clamp and then I'll start tack welding it into position. Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to use my 80 grit sandpaper to clean up the area where I'm going to be welding. Get down to bare metal. And I'll do this and I'll make a clean spot down here on the pinch weld so that I've got a good adhesion point. So now I'm gonna get my MIG welding setup ready to go. Start tacking it into position. Okay, I have an old nasty denim shirt on for a reason. The sparks can get pretty intense. I got burned the other day working in a short sleeve shirt and shorts. I'm not gonna do that again today. You'll also notice that we've got welding blankets inside the car. We've covered up the back seat. We've got our steering wheel and all the stuff back behind me here covered up that we've already worked on a little bit. So we should be good to go. Now I'm going to put our mount in here, clamp it into position. Okay, looks fairly straight. You're not going to get a whole lot of opportunities to go back and fix this after we do that. Now we've got our ground electrode in. You can hear the MIG welder humming in the background. And I've got my welding helmet. So I'm going to go in. Tack in my first spot. All right, I've got those in. I can take my clamp out now so it's not in the way. And just start going in and doing my welding work. All right, I'm gonna employ some power tools. I'm gonna take my grinder and grind down some of these big turd welds that I made. I am not a professional welder. These welds are plenty hot enough that they're gonna hold, but I need to go in and grind down the high spots so that it doesn't look like I welded this in here. And the best way to do that is with one of these. When I'm grinding like that, I like using a face shield. And so now I'm gonna go in and grind down some of these big welds. Okay, now that's an awful lot of work. If I'd taken this to a shop, I would have been done, gone back and picked the car up and been able to go ahead and finish putting my belts in. As it is, I'm pretty happy because it's actually turned out pretty nice. Now I've got to go in and do just a little bit of fill work with some body filler in these small void areas. Put down my paint here in a couple minutes, let it dry for a little while, and then I'll be able to start putting the headliner back in the car. Okay, Vinny's talked to you a little bit about the kit that you should get whenever you're doing the retro belts in the car. And this is a prime example of modifying a kit to make it fit with what you're working on. You'll see that we have the bolt mounted here for our seat belt block, which has all the roll-up belt in it. And we need a floor mount here for the other end of the belts to go up to the B-pillar and down here to our mount point here. And if you put these washers, which you should be using when you're setting up a belt in a car, it's got kind of an angle to it. So what we do is this. We take those plates and we modify them by putting them in a bench vise using a 5-pound sledge and setting this up with an angle on it. Now on the underside, we change the angle a little bit. If you can see here, we've got two different angles on this. We've got a shorter angle on the one up inside the car and a deeper angle from the hole center to here that goes up underneath the car. That way they're basically in the same mounting position. Now the one thing you should always do is check up underneath the car and make sure there's no brake lines or fuel lines in the area where you're drilling this. On a Ford product, those things are right up against the outer pinch wheel, so we're not in any trouble putting a hole here. You'll notice I put a piece of tape on the bear bit. The tape is so I know that that's as far as I need to drill. I'm going to mount this with the tall end of this facing out to give it some clearance around the holster assembly here. Okay, we've got the top of our belt mounted. Now we need to go in and mount the bottom. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a lock washer on our bolt and send our bolt into the stock location at the base of the belt. Now I'm just temporarily mounting these belts so that we can get position. I'm going to go in after we get done and put some Loctite on the bolts. Even though with these fine threads, I'm pretty sure these things aren't going anywhere. Okay, I've got the lower plate on the other side of my fuel line. Lock washer started. I'm going to make sure and keep that lower plate up against the body as much as I can. Okay, it's going to require a 5/8 up top and 11/16 on the bottom. Now we need to go ahead and set up our mounting up here. Now because this clasp right here needs to remain loose, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take one of the larger coarse thread bolts that comes in the parts kit and use it with two nuts and two washers. And basically I'm going to put the bracket in between this and tighten these two together on each other so that this can still rotate, because you want this to rotate whenever you're getting in and out of the car for your forward and backward motion. The only thing I'll say is this may be a little bit noisy for some guys. You might be able to find some kind of plastic insert to put in between the bolt and the clasp here, but once you get in the car, there's tension on the belt, you're probably not going to hear a whole lot of racket out of this. And this is really the best way to mount this up, and basically that's going to sit like this. And I'm not going to sit here and try to show you exactly how that mounts because you won't be able to see anything, but just know that what I'm doing is a double nut setup like this with two lock washers, one on each side of it, and I'm going to tighten these two together so that this buckle remains loose. Oh yeah, I'm happy. The belts turned out super nice. I really like these retro belt setups. Hits my shoulder just right. I'm happy with that. We've got a lot done in the last 3 weeks when you really think about it. I mean, look at what we've had finished up here. We've got our Dakota Digital mirror in. We've got our belts in. We've got a retro sound mic for our Model 2 radio up here. So now we'll be able to receive Bluetooth phone calls through the radio like you would in a brand new car. We've done an awful lot here. But coming back next week, we're going to be working with a different car. We're moving up into the Fox Body Mustang line. Our camera guy, Dustin, has picked up a 88 Fox Mustang hatchback. So we're going to be putting the caster camber plates in that car next week so he can get the front end aligned so he doesn't have to drive around on bald tires anymore. So do us a favor and come back and watch us next week on Auto Resto Mod. Want to go for a drive?